has it gotten us? We have not created a train. We have not created a fan. We have not created, we've not invented anything. So why are we so holding on to this culture, this heritage, when really what we should be actually doing the focus is on education or how some kind of empower young people to drop
the culture. The problem is we're not actually holding on to our culture, because it is culture that educates. I will explain it to you this way. If your culture is not the basis for your education, then your education can never give you knowledge. Okay? So we as Africans, for example, my education has taught me, I always say to my friends, don't ever mistake the answer for the truth. Right? Because the answer is not often the truth. For example, you do exam. Who discovered River Niger? You as a Nigerian, if you want to pass that exam, you have to write Mungo Park. That is the correct answer. But is that answer the truth? So we are educated in lies, because the education is not based on our culture. That is the reason why we have produced more lawyers today in Nigeria than we had in 1960. And we have less justice. We have produced more doctors. We have less healthcare. We have produced more anything you think of. We had more of it today. We have graduated more microbiologists, more anything, but it does not reflect in society. Right? Because that education is not grounded in the culture that it is supposed to represent. So it is the reason why we lack invention, we lack vision, especially in the leadership and elite, because people think it's Nigerians that are lazy. No, the laziness in Nigeria is in the elite and the political and business elites. Those are the truly
lazy. But people believe that Nigerians are lazy, that some Nigerians are lazy.
Yeah, but when people say that Nigerians are lazy, what I realize is that it is the poorest Nigerians that work the hardest. And it is not, in Nigeria is a country where your skill or your talent is not the determinant of your success. We live in a country, whether we like it or not, where success is given. So really, who is an unsuccessful man? Is it a historian? Somebody that is a historian in Nigeria that is great at history, but Nigeria has refused to create a platform for that potential to shine. So he has all this knowledge in his head and he's going around poor. You say he's lazy because he doesn't have anything, any platform to let his, even if you're a nuclear physicist in Nigeria, if you don't run out of Nigeria, you're a talented nuclear physicist, won't you be poor?
Absolutely.
If you're a talented astrophysicist, a theoretical physicist, all these jobs that are the foundations and grounds of invention, what we're talking about, where is the government program? Robotics, aeronautics, rocket engineers, then rocket science, rocket scientists. Where are the avenues for such people to shine in this country? So these people that you're saying they are lazy, isn't it possible that that is where their talent is, that you have just not created the avenue?
Exactly. You're very correct, Joe, because
what is truly laziness? Laziness is to not be able to have the opportunity to, but refuse to fulfill one's potential. And that, for me, is the definition of the Nigerian business and political elites. Because Nigerian elites, the only expression they have for their wealth is luxury. And that is not the full potential of that opportunity. So therefore, they are lazy. Lazier than anybody else in Nigeria. Lazier than even the boys sleeping 24 hours under the bridge, smoking Igbo and drinking all day. Because you have the opportunity to develop a country. You have the resources, but you rather chase girls with it, drink foreign drinks, fly private jets, show off your new house, buy 100 Rolls Royce, and you think that is life, right? So your children will come on Instagram and be flaunting our own commonwealth in our face because you're influencers. has influenced the majority of people or professionals, not really people, but the professionals of Nigeria. I want to carry your cup, come up on my side. Sorry, Auntie Morayo. I think somebody here has corona. I beg.
Please, don't give Seun Kuti corona here.
Which kind of cup will be this one? Not you, they smoke the good. Sorry, Auntie Morayo.
It's okay.
Am I the king? Me. I have a daughter that needs me around. I'm sorry, the cop was just the cop you that way. You have to be afraid of cop. It's like gunshots. These days, if you hear cop and gunshots, you run towards gunshots.
You run. I went somewhere today and they sneezed. I just stopped first. I saw where they sneezed.
Did anybody see me? Did anybody see me release this bomb?
So let's talk about education. I mean, I feel you because Nigerian laziness. Because when I watch CNN and all these international news stations, and they're looking for vaccine, they're looking at the schools, they're talking to universities, professors in Scotland, in UK, they're engaging all their educational, their academias at this period. And here in Nigeria, we have that huge gap, that vacuum that's been created by poor education. How many of our professors can we engage? Yes, we know we can engage professors, but
you see,
how many of them can have these real solutions?
The elite of Nigeria, in cahoots with their political bodies, have come together since the 90s to defund the entire public sector of Nigeria, claiming to us Nigerians that they will replace it with a private sector equivalent, that the government cannot achieve the kind of development that Nigerians need. So government should stop investing in public institutions. They should take that money and give it to our rich people. And then the rich people will in turn provide the goods and services that we Nigerians need. So first of all, because that is what happens in Nigeria, go and look at our health budget. Look at our education budget. Then compare it to AMCON's budget, the bailout budget of 2010. Compared to the concessions, compared to all these loans that they give people, compared to all the waiver in custom. So there's no fund for public. In fact, it was just somebody just pointed out to me that our educational budget, the budget for our education is about 40-something billion for 1 year. While the budget of the Senate is 145 billion for the same 1 year. So about 700 people, I mean, how many people there deserve 145 billion? And 45 education. Billion is for 200 million people. What kind of equation is that? So these people, first of all, they create these private institutions, right? Charging us world-class prices, but paying us local wages.
For sure, they said that government is a facilitator. Government cannot create. I mean, that's what we are told. That government's job is just to facilitate.
That is a false narrative. That is a false narrative. Because the only way you and I, you understand, the only way you and I can be guaranteed that our children can compete in society is if public institutions are functioning. Because then if it is private, then it is only the richest that will have the opportunity.
Afford it.
Then, so we are all now stuck in a race, in a rat race. So you are working in a place now, they are paying you 800,000 a month. But you know that the best school in your area is 2 million a year. And you see children going there. It is your natural instinct as a parent to make sure that the child, that school your child goes to, make sure that your child has the best in life.
Definitely.
You don't want to live in a shabby neighborhood where your child will be exposed to crime. So you move to a nice neighborhood. What is your rent? 3 million a year. Abi? Looking at all the bills we have to pay as Nigerians, matching into the salaries that most of us, even senior professionals have, we'll find out that our salaries do not cover what our elites charge us to exist. Because that is all the Nigerian elites do. They put a price on our existence. So they never venture far into truly developing Nigeria. They like modernizing Nigeria. Because modernization makes the West rich. They are overlords that give them the protection that they need to continue to dominate us. You understand? So the same person that is your boss that is paying you these low wages is the same person that owns the school, that the same people that own the houses, that the same people that own the transportation, the airlines that we take everywhere, that the same people that own everything that we, the same people that sell us food to eat at exorbitant prices. Bill Gates was saying, he was discussing with his friend Dangote on ways to stop.
Dangote is my Nigeria. Uncle, please. Dangote is our
yeah. So him and Bill Gates were discussing about stopping hunger in Nigeria.
Yes.
I listened to the whole interview, and between the two of them, there's no time that they talk about how Dangote's food is too high for the common man in Nigeria to afford. Because that is the real reason why the common man is hungry. Because he cannot afford the food the Nigerian elite are selling.
But we need more Dangote. Okay, let me come to that. Because, listen,
Okay, what please. I'm saying, these same people that give us low wages charge us extremely high prices for their own goods and services, thereby keeping us in ransom, holding us hostage to them. You are beholden to your job. Whatever your boss tells you to do, you have to do it because you have bills to pay. Now, if the institutions were public, and our best schools and our best hospitals and our best transportation companies and all those things were public institutions run with taxpayers' money, with public oversight for the benefit of all, they will not be under such pressure.
Right.
This is 20 years we've been in this democracy now. Where is the federal public housing? Everything is private. They say low income, mid income estates, high income. Where is the federal public housing to compete with private housing in Nigeria? We have been 20 years. Have they built 1 million units? Lagos State government, how many have they built? I will be shouting, Lagos State government is working. Lagos State, homeless people everywhere.
So, but listen, we, the people, voted these guys in ourselves.
We didn't vote them in.
I went to the polls. So.
Because the truth is, we've not really been given an option. We're always giving the option of devil and the deep blue sea.
Right.
Devil, and so that's no real election.
Nobody voted for him. Nobody voted for them.
No, but it's not that nobody voted for them. It's not that nobody voted for them. The truth is that the space is very expensive. So this is what I'm saying. I don't want to say media. And if I now say media, you'll be angry.
No, go ahead.
The truth is that election time, this is why I believe that media should never be privately owned. Privately owned media, even social media, once it's privately owned, becomes anti-people. So, I don't want even Nigerians to look bad at our media. Look at the UK, News of the World, Murdoch and David Cameron going behind the Prime Minister, someone that wanted to run for Prime Minister, going to meet with the owner of a media empire, doing a deal together, and you give him unfettered access. He then exposes his opponent. He started tapping phones of people, exposing, you know. So this is what private media does during elections. They pick sides and forget about the truth. They do not inform Nigerian people. And again, Nigerian people, we are still young in politics. We were banned from politics for over 40 years. Right? In my own generation, this is the first political experiment. We don't have teachers to look back to. We don't have examples to help us. And those that should help the youths with true historical knowledge and organizational skills to give them the resources that they need to politicize themselves, rather distracts the people. You know, so for me, it is not that we voted them in power more than we were strong armed into the position.
Let's talk about solutions now. So we know, Everybody knows the state of the nation. Everybody knows our culture. We don't appreciate our culture. Education is poor. COVID-19 is here. Everybody's thinking of themselves. And we have an opportunity. And the reason why I'm trying to connect this to COVID-19 is that it seems for me, and please correct me if I'm wrong, it seems that this pandemic is giving Africa an opportunity to look within, because now our borders are closed. We can't buy this champagne and all these things from all over the world. We now have to look for the Ogogoro and drink within and look, you know, party within pretty much. Do you think it can be a wake-up call to us as a people to begin to think for solutions going forward and not depend so much on the West like we've done for centuries.
But you see, the thing is that, you can't say depend on the West. It's not just that we depend on the West. There's a culture of dependency. And the culture of dependency is validated by the institutions of influence in society. So our leaders have to justify their own dependent outlook to the world by making Nigerian people feel dependent on them. What am I saying? Nice. I'm saying throughout this whole crisis that we have had, what has our influencers offered the Nigerian people? Have they offered them the opportunity to organize politically? No. They are doing giveaway. So you feel, oh, one big man online is going to give you 5K, you know, try. Just the way we live our lives. You go to church to pray to make it every day. Just keep trying, even though things are not working. So go to the big man's page. Pray to God. God, God, please send a big man my way to bless me. Send me a good job. You know, these same prayers that we pray. So it's not, okay, I always say to people, many people live in their parents' house in Nigeria till they are 30. This is highly unnatural, but it is deliberate. Because our government knows that if a young man becomes independent early and begins to develop independent thoughts, he'll be harder to manage than somebody that is infantilized. So our governments make sure that we African people, we continue to remain infantilized, that we do not grow up. So when you meet a Nigerian man, you know, and woman, but let me just say man, or a Nigerian, let me use person, let me be gender neutral. You meet a Nigerian person, you ask him when when you're in secondary school, what are your dreams in life? He tell you, I want to marry, have children, bring a big house, have a nice car, you know, live good, have fun with my friends. If you meet the same man when he's 60, and you ask him, what are your dreams? If he hasn't gotten those things, there will be no evolve. Even though he has money, you'll still say, oh, yeah, man, I want to make more money, build more houses, have more cars, have more fine girls. We do not grow. And it is deliberate. That's why they infantilize us with the programs that they show us on TV. You know, many people say that music doesn't mean anything. When I say there's too much violence in black music, you say, it should be the Arnold Schwarzenegger acts film and he kills people. I say, you watch Arnold Schwarzenegger's film maybe once a year. Maybe twice if you like the film. But songs that you like, you play it on repeat 100 times a day. If you think listening to something for 2 minutes doesn't affect your psyche, what that thing is promoting, why do you think corporations spend billions of naira advertising their goods on TV on repeat?
Right.
Because that is how the human brain works. You know, you cannot be listening to slap a hoe, beat a bitch, kill a black woman, and say you want to respect your wife. Never. You can't be listening to songs every day that are telling you, don't trust anybody, don't trust anybody. Everybody wants to kill you, everybody is your enemy, and you think you want to develop a nation. Never.
But Shell, so now, our education, as I was saying earlier, our education system is poor. The people that are on the streets don't have the education. Because the truth, at the end of the day, development, technology, digital world is what is here. We need to... What makes the West above us is this thing called technology and education. They are able to solve problems. We are consuming and consuming. You know, we don't create anything.
No, what I made the West in front of everybody else is sheer brutality, not education or technology.
Sorry, share that brutality. Again.
What has put the West ahead of everybody
is brutality.
Is education or technology. Now, it's sheer brutality.
Sheer
genocide, man, inhumanity to man. Because you have to look at many African countries have gotten it right. Congo got it right with Lumumba. What did they do to Lumumba? They killed him. The Belgians and the Americans. What did they do to Nkrumah? What did they do to Sankara? So any African, it is not like as if they leave us to our own means and we do not get it right. I always tell people one of the biggest problems with African liberation is that our leaders don't live to old age. So young revolutionaries like myself and people that want to change this country do not have those people to lean back to go and meet for advice, for strategy, to have them behind us. Go and look at the history of black liberation. It's full of assassinations. Even in this country, in this Nigeria. How many of our revolutionary leaders are around today to guide and lead the youth into the new generation? So there's a constant attack on us in Africa trying to make it. Even when we get it right, we are deliberately sabotaged. Look at Libya. So it is, I will never accept that it is by technology or education that the West has been advanced in the world. No, it is by cultural imperialism and brutality. Go and read about what the Belgians did in Congo. You know, so, I mean, these are the things that...
I want to talk about cultural imperialism. A lot of people didn't understand what I was driving out, you know, because the fact that we absorb the international culture and use it to replace ours. You know, we prefer to wear the weaves. I mean,
yeah,
I have...
because Western people have a way of deceiving people that their culture is universal. You understand? That what their world outlook is not selfish. That when they say things, they're not saying it to benefit white people. That they're saying it for everybody to be good.
It's for our good, though, because
It's important that I feel like it's important that people read this book.
Which one is that? Truth. Is that what is that? It's backwards.
It's backwards. Oh, I don't know how.
Yes, that's where. Yeah.
Okay, let me read it. It's Yurugu, an African-centered critique of European cultural thought and behavior. It's written by Marimba Ani. So I've been going back to reference this book a lot to people these days, because it is important that we also understand the culture that we are up against, the pillars that they have put in place to sustain their own advantages in the world. It is not our place to expect them to dismantle those institutions for us. It is our place to engage in revolutionary struggle to make sure that black people demolish those institutions in our own societies, so we can erect institutions that represent us. I said,
Let me explain to you why.
I said to people, it is not a coincidence that banks don't lend black people money in Europe and America. It is not because they are white owned, because banks that are black owned in Nigeria also do not lend black people money. Is it because the banks in Nigeria are also white owned? No. It is because the institution of banking itself is anti-black.
Anti-black. A deal. Don't break this table.
No, but it's true. I tell people, look at Western institutions. You go to America, they say housing institution. Black people are highest in homeless numbers. Come to Africa, that is our own land. In housing, we black people are also homeless. How many homeless white people are in Nigeria? In all institutions under capitalism, black people are not moving ahead anywhere in the world. Look at the numbers. Go look at the police institutions. The way they are killing black people in America is the way police kill us here in Africa. Is it because the police here are white?
So the root cause of the problem is an international agenda, the colonial agenda against the black race.
It is not the colonial agenda. It is a system of global white domination. And the more we
there's a theory, so let me pause you for a second. There's a theory that a lot of Nigerians feel that we should have remained colonized because maybe we'd have had proper development. Same with South Africa right now, has the West living with them, and they are almost like the most modern or enlightened or colonized, or you can even call it the most 21st century country in Africa. All of us, many Africans feel that we should have actually stayed colonized. What are your thoughts on that?
That is the selfish Africans that have some little change in their pocket because they have good jobs and some little money. How many black people in South Africa have made it? See, we look at all these monuments of capitalism that they erect and say it's development. No, this is modernization. That's not development. Development is you falling down and you can call an ambulance to pick you up. Do you have that? Even though you have
newspapers
and Rolls Royce. If armed robber is in your house, can you call the cops to come and help you?
No.
Exactly. So, why are we talking about private jets and fine malls when black people in South Africa live in some of the most abject neighborhoods in the world, completely neglected? I mean, come on, just because things are white, good for white people in South Africa doesn't mean South Africa is a good country or a developed country. I'm sorry. South Africa is actually one of the most underdeveloped countries in Africa for black people. Because that is what I say. We have to begin to see things from our own perspective. Right. That is one of the solutions to our problem. You know, I mean, how can you think? People that say that we need to be colonized more do not understand, do not know the, because they don't teach them, so they don't understand what colonialism was. We don't want us to realize the brutality.
Sometimes when you talk like this, it's just too deep for some of us. Some of us just feel like, you know what? I want a good life for my family. I can move to Canada. My children, I want peace of mind.
People like that today don't talk about how they want a good country. Because for us to have a good country, I always say to people, the first step to the first step to developing your world is developing your consciousness. You raise your consciousness, you raise your world. Your world cannot be above your consciousness. The situation in Nigeria today, you understand, the level Nigeria is today is the level of our collective consciousness. If we want Nigeria to be better than this, we have to raise our collective consciousness, then Nigeria will raise to meet it. One person can't do it. It's a collective.
That's
effort.
Collective.
Yes. See, one of the things that we don't realize in Africa as black people is that we are children of sacrifice. Even when our ancestors do the rituals, that they drop sacrifice, you know, that is the complete picture of what we are. Under this capitalism, what nobody tells you, you know, when they tell you about this universalism, is that black people were never invited to the table for anything in this system. For a black man to enter the bus, somebody has to die. That's sacrifice. For you as a black man to go to school, somebody has to die. That's sacrifice. We are not allowed. For you to vote, somebody has to die. For you to get that job in media, in oil, in hospital, in any, to be a lawyer, anything, that to even sit down like this in our own homes, in our own country, was sacrifice. Blood was spilled. Without Nkrumah, you and I cannot sit down here today.
Freedom, yeah.
No, freedom is we are free, but completely oppressed in our own land. The slavery was over, but we were under colonialism.
Yeah. Okay, I get
black people do not walk on the same road as white people in our own country. If a white man is walking on the road, you have to step down on the sidewalk and bow your heart. My grandfather refused, they bayonet his eye. You know? So we do not understand the horrors, the sacrifice, because, you know, as soon as we gain, because this is what black people do wrong, we win the war, but we lose the peace. So we kicked out the colonial masters, and we left their trained hoodlums, the Nigerian military, amongst us. We did not disband the military. That was the grave mistake of every African colonial nation, to leave the colonial military and adopt it as a national military. Because in less than 6 years, these their boys that they've been implanted with guns amongst all of us took power all over Africa.
Yeah, that's very correct.
And all the benefits in under 30 years, all the things. Lumumba, Sankara, Nkrumah, Herbert Macaulay, my grandmother, every great Nigerian suffered to fight for. They reversed everything in 30 years till everything got to a head in SAP. When they finally dismantled all the public institutions.
You see, when we talk like this, people get frustrated.
They don't make the connection. We have to understand that we must be intellectual. We must raise our consciousness. We must be willing to do the work. The work is the sacrifice, and that sacrifice is the solution to our problem. We can't not just say we love our country without.
No, some of us must be willing to die. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, death is a part of it. The people that have died are not better than them. Greater men than us.
They didn't plan to die. It just happened.
greater men than us have given their life from us, for us. Steve Biko, you know, being one of the most prominent, you know, one of them. I mean, Sankara, I mean, so many great men. Frontline, my grandmother, thrown out of the window.
Are you willing to die for Nigeria, Sheo?
I'm not willing to die. I'm willing to live for Nigeria.
Okay.
If you're willing to die, is the negative European concept of freedom. It's true. See, willing to live means I already see myself, you know, as the unliving. Mm. I've already accepted that. Now I'm willing to live. And I'm willing to do whatever it takes to live.
Mm.
Programmed to accept is actually a willingness to die. Because I see the way Nigerians live their lives. Because when people say, oh, are you willing to die for freedom? I say to them, living in Lagos, you're already dead. No, I'm telling you, immediately, even in your house, it's dangerous. But maybe in your house, your probability of dying is maybe 45% suddenly. But as soon as you step out of your door in Lagos, your probability of dying goes up to 90%. But none of this make us stay in our house and say we're not going to go out and look for money. So we are willing to die for that money. Because people that were in their car, that container, remember that container that fell from the bridge in Ojo-Elegba and caused people in their car? Were they struggling for freedom? When our billionaires, their trucks explode on the express, billionaires that cannot maintain trucks, that cannot buy world-class good trucks and train drivers, their drivers will be killing people, trucks will be exploding, falling over on the highway, kill 20-something people on the express. How many of them were going to struggle? Were they on their way to protest? So, the people that pipeline exploded under their community in Amuwa-Dofin and kill all of them there. Well, are they struggling? Okay. So we are willing to die already. It's not that we are not willing to die to live. And that is what we have to understand.
So
we
people are asking
to give our lives to help our oppressor continue the status quo, to keep the wheel turning. All of us go out every day running the rat race, helping our oppressors get stronger. But we're not willing to give few times, few seconds, few hours, few days, few months for our own liberation. And that is the real problem of Nigeria. I'm sorry, whatever the solution must be, must start from us raising our consciousness above the level that
it is. In a nutshell, there must be multiple Showerez, multiple Sheunkutis, multiple...
That's why I did not support Showerez's presidential campaign openly. Because I said to him, you cannot liberate the people. Only the people can liberate themselves. You understand? So Showerez being president of Nigeria will never have made Nigeria good or great or solve any of our problem, because he's one man.
The system failure.
We liberate Nigeria, we have presidential candidates, governors in all states, all state assembly, the federal senate, federal assembly, everywhere, we will counsel law. This movement will have people to represent Nigerian people at all levels. I mean, imagine Showerez being the president of Nigeria and has to contend with the PDP and APC-controlled Senate and House of Reps. What will he be able to accomplish? In fact, they will impeach him in 6 months. Or they will frustrate him for that 4 years so bad that Nigerians will never want to hear new leadership again.
So let's imagine for a second. Somebody wakes up tomorrow and says, okay, I want to be president. I'm like a Seun Kuti, for example. And now says, for me to be president, I need to have all representatives already, House of the 774 local governments, let me have your chairman already. Have that. I'm sorry. Oh, yeah, their chairman ready. Let me have their representatives in Senate. Let me have the 36 governors. Have that army of people who are ready to take on the government. That's the only way we can actually have true liberation if we want to.
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes. That's the work. We must do that hard work. That's the hard work that the Nigerian professionals are shying away from. That is your duty, actually. That is my duty. We have been able to accomplish certain things accomplish certain levels of comfort within this oppression, right? Within this oppression, are you listening?
Yeah.
We owe it to our people to liberate them the way things were done for us. The same sacrifices that were made for us to be here today is the same sacrifices that we need to pay forward. This is the work we need to do. This is the only reason why we are here. But instead of us to do that, we instead of aligning with the people, we align with the oppressor and take his trinket, take his things. And because of the things he gives us, we forget our people. We talk down to our people. We blame them for their problems.
Think about your children. You see, sometimes when you want to take kind of
sacrificial steps, you think about your children by creating a healthy community for your children. You cannot cocoon your children in your own little and think, you know, that child is protected.
That's true.
The child is not protected. We are only as strong as the weakest one of us. Okay, because as all of us are professionals today, we are still susceptible to as many dangerous things as the poorest Nigerians are. Maybe we are just able to ameliorate our situation.
That's very true. Somebody said we are one sickness away from poverty.
What did you say?
Somebody said we are all one sickness away from poverty.
Yes, so. One sickness. It's true. Everybody doing big boy, trying to be what we are not, you know. But it's true. How many people look at COVID? I can't tell you how people are trying to borrow money from me. But this, like I said to us, we should not judge ourselves harshly. How many European companies, big multinational companies, have declared bankruptcy because of only 3 months of lockdown? Where is their savings? They'll say black people, we are thrifty. We don't like to save money. All these big companies closing down, where is their own savings?
So we'll be too hard on ourselves.
Nobody can save in capitalism. Except you are part of the elites, the top 1%. And that's why they are conservatives. Because they want to keep conserving the people's wealth.
I've always asked this question, Seun. Do you think democracy would work for Africa? I mean, do you think we should begin to redo our democracy? Or, let me see, customize this democracy? Because sometimes, I just think about it. I wish the president can just take a decision and say, you know what, I'm taking a drastic action. Because sometimes, this judicial process takes so long sometimes.
Any system we choose will work. The problem is we just have to make sure we just have to make sure that we remove saboteurs and traitors from within us. As I said, the mistake our ancestors made, and that doesn't make them even any less great, is that we trusted in the universalism of European ethics. But it was only rhetorical. I always say to people this example, like I learned from this great Dr. Marimba Ani. Like, when white people came and said they were trying to make us Christians, what does it mean to be a Christian? It means to be Christ-like.
Right.
But if you look at history, you realize that our people were Christ-like to white people. We welcomed them, we fed them, we housed them, we protected them. You know, we welcomed them and shared with them. This is the Christian way. And what do they say about us for acting like Christians? Because they didn't teach us, they said we were naive. And we believe that lie, that our ancestors were naive. No, our ancestors were just good people. So people, they made some certain mistakes that it is now our duty to make sure that we do not make again. So we fought for our independence. We chased out the white people. But we left their army, the people, the black people that were protecting white people from black people. That is what Nigerian army is. That's how they started, Nigerian army and police. Go and read your history. That's why they can never respect black people. That's why the Nigerian army can kill black people anyhow. Nigerian police can kill us anyhow. Because that is what they were originally trained to do. The Nigerian army and Nigerian police were the black people, the traitors amongst us, that were willing to kill their fellow brothers to protect black interests in Africa. Let them come and deny it. Bring their history. Let's see who formed them, what their jobs were, what they were doing in Nigeria before. What what was Babangida and Buhari doing when we were struggling for colonial independence? They should tell us, give us their diary. What were you doing that time in 1960? You were not children. What was Obasanjo doing in 1960? Was he part of the anti-colonial struggle?
They weren't.
Let them all of them come and say, all these military men running this country to the wall, sinking us into debt unnecessarily, putting us into bondage of the Europeans, the masters that trained them. Because I would like it or not, we are still under this man. Let them come and tell us that they fought for our independence.
All the curses we've cursing these men for 20, 30 years. Omamuo, they are alive and well.
No, I'm not cursing them. Have I cursed them?
Not you. I'm talking about this Babangida, Obasanjo, the military, that clique. All
yes,
of us.
So D.Y. Danjuma, all of them, go on.
They are alive and well.
This is endless. You know? So let them come and tell us.